Can you hear me? Praise the Lord. Forgot the headset. Well, praise God. I'm so grateful to be here this morning. Welcome, church. Welcome to Restoration Church of Sanford. I'm so grateful that you're here with us to worship the Lord. It's the Lord's day. This is the day that the Lord has made for us to come and worship Him. And so I'm so excited to be here with you this morning. Before we enter our service, our brother Trey is going to come up and read our call to worship.
Our call to the worship today is going to be out of Psalm 89, verses 1 through 4, and it reads, I will sing of the steadfast love of the Lord forever. With my mouth I will make known to your faithfulness to all generations. For I said, steadfast love will be built up forever in the heavens, and you will establish your faithfulness. You have said, I have made a new covenant with my chosen one. I have sworn to David, my servant, I will establish your offspring forever and build your throne for all generations. Let's pray. Father, we come before you this morning on your day, and we just ask that you be with us. We ask that you remove any distractions or any hindrances that might keep us from worshiping you properly today, and just help us to stay focused on your cross and the sacrifice that you made for us, Lord. Help us to give you all the glory this morning, Lord. We love you and praise you. It's in your Son, Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning, church family. Why don't you stand with me and let's worship the Lord. I was sinking. Sing it out. I was sinking deep in sin, far from the peaceful shore. Very deep. Stained within, sinking to rise no more. But the master of the sea heard my despairing cry. From the waters lifted me, now safe am I. Love lifted me, love. Could help, love lifted me. the Lord a praise this morning. That's our story, amen. His love has lifted us. How deep the Father's love for us, how vast beyond all measure, that He should give His only Son to make a wretch His treasure. How great the pain of searing loss, the Father turns His face away.
Praise the Lord, how deep the Father's love for us. Don't we need to hear that this morning? Praise the Lord. Well, we're going to read together in unison the Nicene Creed. This is a statement of belief that the church has said for the last 1,700 years. And so we're going to reaffirm this gospel confession together this morning. Please read along with me from the Nicene Creed. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of the Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary and was made man and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and the third day he rose again according to the Scriptures and ascended into heaven and sits on the right hand of the Father, and he shall come again with glory to judge the quick and the dead, whose kingdom shall have no end. And I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. You may be seated. At this time, children may be dismissed to children's church, and they should be able to meet their instructors in the back. This time, we're going to recite for you a portion of the 1689 London Baptist Confession of Faith. And this, again, is a statement of belief in some of the more specifics of what we believe as Reformed Baptists. And so this is coming from chapter 16, article 6, Confession on Good Works. And this is what it says. Nevertheless, believers are accepted through Christ, and thus their good works are also accepted in Him. This acceptance does not mean our good works are completely blameless and irreproachable in God's sight. Instead, God views them in His Son, and so He is pleased to accept and reward that which is sincere, even though it is accompanied by many weaknesses and imperfections. Now, isn't that a good thing? That Jesus washes our works, that even our best works are still tainted by sin, but Christ, through what He has done, cleanses them so that the Father in heaven is pleased with us. So this is, again, praise the Lord. And now we're going to move into a time of prayer. And I just want to observe that, you know, Jesus' disciples never asked Him, how to cast out demons, how to do many things, but they did ask Him how to pray. And I think that's because Jesus, in a very powerful way, when He prayed, they knew there was something special as He prayed to the Father. So as we have a time of prayer now, we begin with adoration, thanking God for who He is. And so we're just going to take a minute now. There should be a couple prompts on the screen. And just take a moment to yourselves to pray through these prompts. Lord God, we praise You as the source of all riches, all wisdom, all justice, and all power. And Lord, we thank You, for Your word teaches us how to walk in Your ways. O Lord, we offer up our praise to You. To You alone belong all glory, honor, and might, majesty, dominion, and power. In Jesus' name, amen. And as we consider the holiness and power of God, we also recognize our own sinfulness. We recognize that we need to be forgiven. And so now we want to move into a time of confession, of praying and asking the Lord to forgive us for the sins we've committed this week, this day, this morning, right? And trust that if we confess these to the Lord, He will cleanse us through the blood of Jesus. So please, as you see the prompts now, pray this time. Oh Lord, You're patient with us. God, You're so, we're prone to take advantage and forget Your goodness, God. Lord, thank You that we can confess our transgressions daily and quickly, and You are quick to forgive and to turn us back to You. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. And now lastly, we'll have a time of corporate prayer. Being forgiven by the Lord, we now want to pray together and pray for one another. And so there should be one more. Just pray as the Lord leads you. We pray just at this time, try to put out any time of catching up or distractions, and just share with one another, and let's pray for 2 minutes together. thank you for your church and for the opportunity to love others by praying for them and with them in times of celebration and praise and in times of sorrow and mourning. Lord, we praise you for caring for our needs and for the privilege of coming to you in intercession for others. God, thank you for this time. And Lord, may we come joyfully towards you with our minds and our hearts. Help us, God, to worship you this morning as we hear your word and respond. We pray this all in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. At this time, we'll transition now in worship to hearing some mission updates from Michelle Stewart.
Good morning. As Zach said, my name is Michelle Stewart, and it is my pleasure to welcome you to Restoration Church on this beautiful summer morning. It's a privilege to be here in the house of the Lord. I had an opportunity to be at a women's conference this past week and gather with 9,000 women singing worship music, and I was struck by the fact that that was what heaven's going to be like. It was powerful. But then I felt the Lord reminded me that every Sunday is a foreshadowing of that. When we gather together, one day every tongue, every tribe, every nation is going to gather together to do that. But we do it weekly right now as a testimony that we look forward to that day. So I'm glad you're here. And as I said, I want to extend a warm welcome to you. And if this is your first time to join us, I want to let you know that we believe that we thrive best in community. We want to connect with you, and we want to connect you to us. So on the back of the chair in front of you and at the end of each row, you should find a connect card. And if you'll fill that card out and drop it by the welcome table, we will connect with you this week. And we have a gift for you. It's a small gift, but it's our way of saying, hey, we're really glad you're here. We notice you, and we really do value you. On the back of that card, you'll see that there's a place to enter a prayer request, because we believe we thrive best in community, and we pray for you by name when you fill that out. If it's a personal request that you don't want shared, indicate that as well so we can handle that appropriately. So we are a church on mission. We believe that our purpose here is to proclaim Jesus. And to borrow a phrase from the conference that we just went to, we want everybody to behold and believe that Jesus Christ is the way, the truth, and the life. And that no man can come to the Father except through him. So we're serious about this. So every week we share what we're doing. Today we're highlighting one of our ministries that's near and dear to my heart. It's our Family Advocacy Ministry, or FAM Ministry. And we exist to support vulnerable families that are either entering into the foster system through no fault of their own. These children enter into care. We want to love on them. We want to love on the families that are loving on them. So we build communities that support them. Our verse is a powerful verse, and it's an admonition from the Lord. Psalm 82, verses 3 and 4. Defend the poor and the fatherless. Do justice to the afflicted and the needy. Deliver the poor and the needy. Free them from the hand of the wicked. So that is why we exist, and we want you to know that there are many ways that you can be a part of this. We know that not everyone can foster, but everyone can care. So I'm going to tell you a few ways that you can engage in this ministry. But first, I'm going to show you a preview of a movie that is raising awareness for the plight of the families that are in foster care right here in the United States.
It's hard to feel like I'm the only one who sees these things. 70% of the kids in the system are there because of neglect. The other 30% are put through hell. We need your help. Can you imagine Huggy's O'Neill? We can't just look away. The state ain't no family.
Are you sure these people want us?
I know they do. You can call me Mama. Oh, Lord.
If we can't wrap our arms around the most vulnerable, then what do we have? Noise! And the children can't take the noise anymore.
This is something that we must do.
22 families want to adopt.
Whole town wants kids now.
That's about right.
What's happening with Possum Trot could mean a huge change for the system.
We want the ones that nobody else want.
Who hurt you, baby? I'm not giving up on you. You can't give up on me either. What are we gonna do? Everybody's falling apart.
I'm doing the best I can.
The real world hits hard.
I don't wanna be here!
I can't give him back.
We gotta work on this together. We your people now. And love never gives up.
I know that was a powerful clip, right? We your people now, right? That's what the church should be saying. And we would love for you to join us. That movie comes out July 4th. And the Angel Studios has done a great job of bringing the plight to our doorstep. What are we going to do with that? That church in Texas said, no more. No more children without families. And they tackled that problem. And there were more families to foster than there were children that needed to be fostered. So we can do this together by God's grace. It is not our job to do it, but He can do it through us. So we're inviting you to engage with our ministry. You can give to support our fam care ministry. In July, we are going to have a picnic party for the foster care families in Central Florida. And every dollar that you give to fam care will allow those children to participate at the splash pad or have a snack. We want the foster families of Central Florida to know they're seen and they're loved and we care for them. So one more thing before we go to worshiping through our giving. Next Sunday, we have a very special day. It's a rhythm of our church to gather and fellowship. It's our family fellowship Sunday. But this Sunday coming up, we want to honor our Recovery House men. These guys come every Sunday. Yes. They come every Sunday early. They set up. They come and attend, and then they break down. So y'all come on out and love on them, all right? All right, so lastly, let's turn our hearts to worship through giving. So as the ushers come forward, we're going to let you know that there are several ways that you can give. You can give through the baskets as they come by. There should be a QR code on the screen. You can use that QR code as well. I did forget to mention that you can find out everything that we do, the printed bulletin that we have, but also if you have not done so, you can go to the Church Center app, select Restoration Church. You can give there. You can find out all about what we do. So you can give online as well, or you can text any amount to 84321. All right, so let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, it's a privilege to gather today, and we are grateful. My heart is filled with gratitude for all that you've given us. I'm grateful that now we can hear your word proclaimed. I pray that you prepare our hearts to do so. Thank you for the opportunity to give back to what you are doing in us and allowing us to be done or working through us. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Praise the Lord. Good morning, Restoration Church. Can you hear me? Fantastic. I'm Don, an elder here. It's my pleasure to be with you this morning, and thank you for joining us as we continue in Romans chapter 13. That will be on page 552 of the Blue Bible, if you need that, and 892 on the Black Bible. And I'm going to read 1 through 10, but this morning we're going to concentrate on verses 10 through 13, and that's ultimately going to show that God requires from his people that they love him beyond all else and that they love their neighbors as themselves. That's a theme in the Gospels. So please stand with me as we read Romans 13, 1 through 10. Let every person be subject to the governing authorities, for there is no authority except from God, and those that exist have been instituted by God. Therefore, whoever resists the authorities resists what God has appointed, and those who resist will incur judgment. For rulers are not a terror to good conduct, but to bad. Would you have no fear of the one who is in authority? Then do what is good, and you will receive his approval. For he is God's servant for your good. But if you do wrong, be afraid, for he does not bear the sword in vain. For he is the servant of God, an avenger who carries out God's wrath on the wrongdoer. Therefore, one must be in subjection, not only to avoid God's wrath, but also for the sake of conscience. For because of this, you also pay taxes, for the authorities are ministers of God, attending to this very thing. Pay to all what is owed to them, taxes to whom taxes are owed, revenue to whom revenue is owed, respect to whom respect is owed, honor to whom honor is owed. Owe nothing or owe no one anything except to love each other. For the one who loves another is fulfilled the law. For the commandments, you shall not commit adultery, you shall not murder, you shall not steal, you shall not covet, and any other commandment are summed up in this word. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. Love does no wrong to a neighbor. Therefore, love is the fulfilling of the law. Let's pray. Father, we do thank you for our time this morning to gather and to gather freely. We're so grateful. The gospel does tell us that we are to love one another as Christ loves us. And by doing so, the watching world will know we are your disciples. So help us hear, help us do, help us love this and every morning. We thank you for Pastor Jeremy, who will faithfully lead us by proclaiming your truth this morning. We do pray and give thanks, because your love never gives up. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Please be seated.
Praise the Lord. Well, good morning, church. I'm so grateful. Good morning. Thank you for saying it back. I appreciate that. I'm so grateful to be here with you this morning presenting the Word of God. I don't know if you have seen the theme that has been throughout all of our songs, even in our mission update, but it is about love, loving God, and ultimately loving others. And this morning, we are going to focus on that in our time in the Word. I'm grateful for Pastor Arthur, who presented us a powerful sermon on the Christian and governmental authority. And I know with the election season in full swing this year, it might be beneficial for you and for those who know you to keep that sermon in your back pocket to remind you who's truly in control. The news is going to tell you all number of things of who's in control or who's secretly in control, but I want you to know that God reigns over it all. We have nothing to fear. We have nothing to be scared of because we have a God that has it all in his hands. And I know many of us know the struggles, the debates, and even the divisiveness that comes with political seasons. At times, it can feel like it's good against evil, or in some cases, less evil against greater evil. That's what it feels like, right? Picking between the lesser of two evils. And it's so easy to forget that God indeed is in control of the governmental authorities and everything around us. So I just pray that that would ground you and really please look back to that sermon, but really pray through the passage, Romans chapter 13, specifically verse 1 to 7 as you're going through this season. But after leaving Arthur's sermon last week, I can see how our human nature might say, I affirm these Christian responsibilities to the government and to others, but it doesn't mean that I have to like it. Right? Some of us, at times, we keep our responsibilities, but we do so begrudgingly. We do it because we have to. It's like the kid who's told by his parents to take out the trash, and they only do it because they have to. And depending on what type of house you grew up in, you don't take out the trash, you can expect a chancla in the back of the head. All right, depends on how you grew up. Right? We don't usually follow the speed limit because we care for the police or even for those around us, but we follow the speed limit so we don't get a ticket. And for some of us, if we had a pass to go as fast as we wanted to, we would be speeding everywhere. And there's some of you who already do that anyway, so I'll be praying for y'all, all right? Paul, in our passage this morning, he doesn't want people who are begrudgingly following God's word or people who neglect others, but he wants us to love others because love fulfills the law of God. This morning, I want to ask the question that is brought forth from our text, and it's the title of my sermon this morning. The question is, what's love got to do with it? All right, when we look at this text, we're going to ask the question, what's love got to do with it? And before we start, I want to pray for us. So let's go to the Lord in prayer together. Almighty God, we are grateful for your gracious mercy and your mighty hand over us this morning. I pray that you would not only encourage us with the word, but you would also convict us of sin. I pray that we would leave this morning loving others for the sake of God's glory and for the sake of our good. Illuminate our minds and hearts this morning. In your mighty name, Jesus, I pray and give thanks. Amen. So our text this morning continues where Pastor Arthur left off. And if you want to look down at your Bibles for me, in Romans chapter 13, looking at verse 7, and I'm going to read it for us. This is what it says. Pay to all what is owed to them. Taxes to whom taxes are owed. Revenue to whom revenue is owed. Respect to whom respect is owed. And honor to whom honor is owed. Paul identifies all these different areas where the Christian has the responsibility to pay a debt. But what you need to see in this list here is that it extends to the whole of our lives. For a lot of us in our lives, we compartmentalize things. We say, I'm going to obey in this area. I'm going to show respect in this area. But that's not how Paul writes it out in the text for the believer. It's over the whole of our lives. And so with Paul, with this thought in his mind, goes to verse 8, and he says, "Owe no one anything." Some of us here in this room, we owe somebody $5. We're like, whew, I got to figure that out. He says, "Owe no one anything." You see, Paul wants every single believer to not be outstanding in different debts and responsibilities that we have. But Paul wants us to give to all what is owed to them, whether it be governmental officials, whether it be bosses, whether it be our family, whether it be the church, whatever it might be, whatever's owed, we want to make sure that that is taken care of. And I want to make sure that it's clarified here that what this text is not saying is that we could never borrow money. Because some of us, the only way that you might have gotten a house, the only way that you might have gotten your car is that you borrowed money to do so. And some might read this text and say, well, I just can't do that anymore. That's not what he's saying here. If we look at the Old Testament, it gave provision for borrowing and lending money. We see this referenced in Exodus 22, 25 to 27. And even Jesus reiterates this in Matthew 5, 42. The part that the Bible speaks against is borrowing money and never intending to pay it back, or purposely allowing a debt to be outstanding without paying it. And I have to tell you, I have my sister here. There have been times as siblings, if you've had siblings, where you asked them to let you borrow $5, and you knew 100% you were not giving that money back. Right? I don't know if you've been there, right? Psalm 37:21, it says, "The wicked borrows but does not pay back, but the righteous is generous and gives." Right? And some of y'all, you're like, "I'm waiting on that person to pay me back." I'm going to let you know right now, they ain't paying you back. But I don't want us to get stuck on money, right? So it's so easy for us to fall there. But there are other areas of life that God calls us not to have outstanding debts. And the text before, right, says honor and respect towards others when it's due. And I think of the fact that we have difficulty with this. And for a lot of us, even maybe in your current job, where you have bosses in your workplace that might be difficult to work with, and in some cases you feel like they're not even qualified to be your boss, or maybe you might even describe them as incompetent. But God has called you as a believer in Christ to honor and respect them independent of who they are. That's our obligation. And even here in the church setting, I know, because I have experienced this myself, that we have been in a lot of church situations where pastors, deacons, and leaders did not act like godly men or godly people, where they took advantage, where they served themselves and their own purposes. And we ask the question, how do I honor my pastors and deacons when I've experienced pastors and deacons who have taken advantage of people? How can I honor the family of God when all the churches I've been to have taken advantage of me? It's hard to then come to another church and trust, even if they're a good pastor, good deacons, or a good church. Even if they're loving on me, it's hard because you got one arm stretched out because of what you've experienced. And it's helpful to know for us that independent of what others have done, my obligation for honor and respect is based on the office and the authority God has established. And it's due to those pastors and to those deacons who are faithfully laboring for the sake of the gospel. It's due to those brothers and sisters in Christ who are actively trying to advance the word of God, who are trying by the Spirit to walk in a way that's glorifying and honoring to God. But it's due to them. You see, Paul wants us to have no outstanding debts or not borrow what we don't intend on giving back. But then we see Paul makes a shift in our text to let us know what he wants us to be in debt to. Look back at verse 8. It says, owe no one anything except to love each other. You see from our text, you have a debt that you owe. We owe a debt of love to our families, to our church, to the community around us. We have a continuous debt, and what we owe is love. This is a debt that we will never finish paying off. It's a debt that continues all of your life. You can't say, I did my job. I love them good enough. Now I can be selfish, or now I can do my own thing, or now I don't have to do that anymore. But it's a continuous act of your life. You see, we as believers don't have an option to pick and choose who we want to love. And a lot of times we do that because there's people that we prefer more than other people. But the Bible doesn't give us that option. It calls us to love others. But you see, we owe this love to those around us. And this, as believers, should be our chief concern. And a lot of times we're concerned with so many other things. So many things that surround our world and our life we are concerned about. But the Bible's telling us to be concerned with loving others. That we would live lives that are saturated with loving others well. Let it be said of us that we are a loving people. And I want to ask you a question that I want you to really think. If you were to be removed from your workplace where you're at, if you were to be removed from this church, if you were to be removed from your family, would that debt of love be noticed? Would people notice? Ah, man, that person's not here anymore. Used to give me a hug, ask me how I'm doing, ask me about my family. I knew they loved me well. Man, I really miss them. You know, at the end of July, and I know he's going to hate this, at the end of July, Trenton is moving away. And by the grace of God, hopefully he'll come back. But I know for us here, once Trenton leaves, we're going to notice that debt of love. Right? Amen? If you know Trenton. That smile, that caring hug, that love, I know that he's not here. It's going to be noticeable. But can we say that about ourselves in the different areas of our life? You see, this debt of love isn't something that we do for fun or when we're in the mood. But this debt of love is for the sake of God's glory and ultimately for our good. And how do we know that? Look at the end of verse 8. It says, except to love each other, for the one who loves another has fulfilled the law. You see, loving others fulfills the law of God. And I want to be clear here. We do not love to receive love back. Right? That's what the world does. I'm going to take care of you because I know that you're going to take care of me. We don't love to fill up our good karma. We don't love so that good stuff can happen to me. Yeah, I love that person who really didn't deserve it, so I know I got good waiting for me on the other side. No. We don't love because it's financially beneficial to do so. Some people love on their bosses because they know their bosses control their paycheck and their hours, right? And in different situations, it's financially beneficial for you to love that person. But that's not why the believer loves. We love because it glorifies God by fulfilling his law. I love this. When Jesus is asked, what is the greatest commandment? Look at what Matthew 22:37-40 says. And he said to him, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the great and first commandment. And a second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments depend all the law and the prophets. All of it. On these two things. Love God and love neighbor. God makes it clear that love for God and love for neighbor covers all of God's law. You see, the greatest act of love that fulfilled the law of God was secured for us through Jesus Christ. Because of Jesus, all of our sin debt is paid. All of it. Jesus has done everything perfectly. So what does that mean for you and me, who is a sinner who's saved by the grace of God? What it means is when we fall short of loving others, which we will, which we have, Jesus perfectly paying our debt means that everything doesn't rest on me. So when I fail and I fall short, and I will, and you will, it rests on the grace of God. I don't need to live in shame and guilt of my mistakes and my shortcomings, even though there are many. But I can rest on the all-sufficient work of Christ on my behalf. So you can love freely. You can ask God by His Spirit to help you to love others well. And know even when you fall short, God's grace and mercy is there to pick you up. And that's a help for us. Because so many of us have made so many mistakes in our life, and we just feel like I shouldn't even try. But Jesus' perfect life and Him perfectly loving others, perfectly fulfilling the law on our behalf, helps us to move forward. And for that, I say praise God for His grace and mercy. And we see that our passage here tells us that love fulfills the law of God. And here it is. Christians are called to owe nothing to anyone except to love others, thus fulfilling the law of God. That's your duty and that's mine. But what we need to know is that this love that we're referring to that fulfills the law, it's not subjective. And the reason I say this, because many people use the word love but have many different definitions. Love is ultimately used to justify sinful lifestyles or not speak truth to someone, because it comes off as judgmental and not loving. But we see that Paul gives the standard and the means by which we are called to love others. So it's not something that we choose or how we see it, but the Bible gives a clear definition. And I love even Paul writes in 1 Corinthians about love. Love is patient. Love is kind. If you've ever been at a wedding, you've probably heard those words spoken before about love. Believes all things, bears all things. But look at what it says here in our text. Look at verse 9. For the commandments, you shall not commit adultery. You shall not murder. You shall not steal. You shall not covet. And any other commandments are summed up in this word, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. We see Paul in verse 9 appeals to the Ten Commandments. These aren't placed here as simple rules to follow, but these are the standard of our love. You see, God's law teaches us how to love others. Like I said before, the Ten Commandments are split into two parts. One has to do with our relationship with God, and the other has to do with our relationship with others. And just going down this list that Paul has provided, we can see how we are called to love others. Right, we see first, you shall not commit adultery. One, we see faithfulness in marriage as a loving act towards spouse and towards others. Second, we see you shall not murder. We see caring for others and valuing the sanctity of life as a loving act towards others. It says you shall not steal. It's sharing with others and providing for others shows your love towards others. And it says, you shall not covet, meaning that you're being content with what you have. It means that you're loving God for what he has given you and loving others by not desiring their things. And all of this can be summed up in loving our neighbors as ourself. This is the standard for which God has set up for his people, and this is the true definition of love. And the perfect model of this is shown in the life of Jesus. He showed us what it looks like to live a perfect life, fulfilling the law of God. He loved people perfectly. He was patient with people perfectly. He did everything that was required of him perfectly on our behalf. And as we stated before, this love isn't just toward God, but it's toward others. And usually that's the hard part, because the others are hard people. Amen if you're a hard person. Amen. I'm right there with you. See, loving others means our actions have significant effects on those around us. You know, a lot of times we live as if we're in our own world and as if we're the God of our own life, doing our own thing. And if my actions bother you, then you're the problem. But our text makes it clear that our actions, they affect others. It affects our families. It affects our church. It affects our friends. And we've even seen this on the church side. When you have pastors who you love and trust, who have moral failings, and even in your own experience and hurts from the church, just people around who have said things to you, who have hurt you, we know how those things affect us. And we see that in the commandments that Paul mentions, when these things are disobeyed, we not only see the devastation in our lives, but we also see the significant effect on those around us. And we know the damage of these things done in marriages, families, and in churches. And we see how these things have impacted the view of Christ and the local church. Right? There's been people who have been hurt in church, and they said, I'm not going to step foot in another church ever again because of the actions of others. God wants us to know that not only do we have an obligation to love others, but we are to love others in the way God has called us to. What's important about this text, it is not done outside of the working of the Holy Spirit. I want to let you know, you can't do it on your own, as much as you try. And some of us have tried to live a good life on our own, to do the right thing on our own, and we ultimately see that we fail every time. But it's only by the power of the Spirit that we can refrain from sin and truly obey the law of God. And I want you to know that this obedience, right, is helped by the Holy Spirit, and it is completed, empowered, and saturated in love. It needs to be. It cannot be separated from love. You see, love for God and love for neighbor is the motivation. But a lot of people feel like the law of God is somehow separated from the love of God. One pastor who I would deem as a false teacher claimed that Jesus broke the law of God for love, that he did so for the sake of love. And in our culture today, a lot of evil, selfish decisions have been made in the name of love. Marriages have been torn apart in the name of love. Parents have left and neglected children in the name of love. Children have left and neglected parents in the name of love. Love has been used as an excuse to commit whatever a person's heart desires. We have had people who have taken the word of God out of context and made God's law something that is judgmental and hurtful, while making God's love inclusive of every single thing. But I want you to know that that's not what we see in the Word of God. You see, the law of God and the love of God are inseparable from one another. The greatest way to love others is found in our obedience to the law of God. And our obedience to the law of God is the most loving thing you can do for others. We have to have a right view of God's love and a right view of God's law. We have to know that the law is summed up in love for your neighbor. It's all summed up there. So if we don't have that love, then we're not fulfilling his law. You see, the law of God is the perfect standard of love from which God calls his people to obey. And if you look down with me at verse 10, it sums up the point of this passage. It says, love does no wrong to a neighbor. Therefore, love is the fulfilling of the law. And I want to capture some practical points from our text this morning that I pray is going to be helpful for you. One, we see wronging others denies the love of God. Wronging others denies the love of God. When we do wrong and evil to others, we deny the love of God and we misrepresent Christ. Every time that you have an interaction with someone and you do not love them well or you purposely hurt them, you are misrepresenting Christ. Think about that. Second, love in our hearts for others is the indicator of our relationship with God. I don't know if you've ever been in a car and you're driving and that check engine light comes on. That's probably one of the worst feelings in the world. One of the worst feelings. Because you're like, it's either a quick fix or my car is done, right? And if you have a, you know, you're riding in a Dodge Rainier, I've had this conversation with Trenton. He's been there many of times, so he can tell you about that experience. But love in our hearts is the indicator of our relationship with God. When we are focused on ourselves, on our own lives, and our own plans, we neglect the love for others. We do. Third, love for our neighbor means we have a care for the lost. You know, I recently, Pastor Arthur talked about us going to the Southern Baptist Convention, and they commissioned all these missionaries that went out, and all these churches are talking about their gospel endeavors and reaching college campuses and all the different things they were doing. And I sat there at the convention, and I was so convicted. Because I was so focused on my life and all the things going and even the interworkings of our church that sometimes your eyes can be deviated from the mission of the gospel. Even why we're here in Sanford. And I thought it's so easy for us to get wrapped in our own lives. And even as I think about our church plant, we can get so wrapped up in the work and even the physical building of the church that we neglect and forget about our mission to bring the gospel to the lost here in Sanford. And why? Because we lost our love for them, for the lost. But praise God, by his grace and mercy, he restores us, he renews us, he sets our eyes back on Christ and back on the mission so we can love others well. Fourth, love is how we fulfill the law of God. If we care to love God and his word, we will be concerned with obeying his word. It isn't just something we just throw to the side. It isn't something that we just open up on Sunday, but it's the whole of our lives because we love him. Fifth, our gospel witness is measured by how we love others. The Bible makes it clear, they will know you are my disciples by how you love one another. If we can't even love each other here in the local body, how can we be a witness to the outside world? How? How can we care for others, care for the lost, when we don't even care for the brothers and sisters here in the room? And last, our love for others puts the righteous and holy love of God on display for all to see. How we love others is how the world around us sees Christ in us. See, let our love be a witness to the God that we serve. Let people see this God who has transformed and saved us in our lives. Let them see something different that they don't see in the world around them. Let them see Christ by how you love. You see, without the love of God working in our hearts, moving and motivating us, we can't love others, thus we won't fulfill the law of God. We need the love of God. So to answer our question from the beginning of this sermon, what's love got to do with it? The answer is everything. Everything. Every area and ounce of our life. And where is that modeled and displayed? It's displayed in Christ. It displayed that he gave of his life out of love so that we could be freed from our sin. So that we can have a hope not only in this life, but also in the one to come. To know that everything in my life can be a mess, everything in my life can be struggle and frustration and hardship, but I can still love others freely. I can still display Christ. But it has everything to do with it, with love. As the scriptures make it clear, if you have not love, you have nothing. Nothing. You can be the most talented person in the world. If you have not love, you have absolutely nothing. Brothers and sisters, I ask that you check your hearts this morning and even check your motives this morning, because you could be doing a lot of good things, a lot. But if you have not love, you have nothing. Do you do things out of love for God and love for neighbor? Or has your life and your sin and the burdens in your life so consumed you that the love of God has been squeezed out of your life? I want to give you hope this morning. You can come before the Lord and confess your sin and find freedom to love. You can do it this morning. How is it that the God of the universe, who sees rebels like us, he reigns over everything. He gives us the air that we breathe every single day, and we rebel against him. We think, I'm the God of my own life. I do what I want to do. And by his great love and mercy, he extends grace to us. And not only that, he makes us sons and daughters of God. He gives us a part of his son's inheritance that we had nothing to do with. His perfect life, his righteousness, when we are in Christ, is accredited to our account. He places it on us. So that when you die, and we all will die one day, when you stand in front of God, God doesn't see you in your sinful life. You know what he sees? He sees Christ and his righteousness that's placed on us. And he says, well done, my good and faithful servant. Not because of anything we did, but because of what Christ has done. That's a great love. And that's the love that God wants in his people. And he can help us to do that by his Spirit working in us. You see, there are two extremes this morning. You could be the person who is doing the bare minimum, trying to meet the requirements of the law on your own, trying to do everything in your own effort, in your own power, trying to pick yourself up by your bootstraps, saying, I can do it. And I would tell you that you need the perfect love that only comes from God. You can't do it on your own. You just can't. As much as you try, all the effort you put in, it's going to be wasted outside the working of God in his love. And on the other hand, you have the person who doesn't know or experience the love of God. Their life is so consumed with what they're doing and what's happening next in their life that they look away from all the different things and just focus on themselves. And what they need to do, if you're that person in this room right now, you need to look away from yourself and look to Christ. And deny yourself. And realize that you need him. All the things that you're striving for, guess what? They're going to fade away. Like sand in your hands on a windy day. But the thing that stands is God and his word. You see, Christ, by his finished work, can empower you to love others like he loved for the sake of God's glory and for our good. Y'all, it's for our good that we love others freely, that we honor and glorify God with our lives. Don't leave this morning without putting the love of God that causes you to love others, thus obeying the perfect law of God. Don't leave here without that in your heart. Don't leave here with your selfishness wanting to do what you want to do. But place it at Christ on the cross. Lay your burdens down. God, help me. Help me to be free to love you and to love others. Help me to forgive those who have hurt me, who have wronged me. Let me love freely that I might glorify you and honor you. And by the working of your spirit, fulfilling your law, that you may be praised and honored in all things. And so we're going to have a time where we're going to worship and we're going to sing. And I encourage you, if you need to go before the Lord and confess your sin, I encourage you to do that at that time. If you are in a place where you have no love in your heart, the love of God has been squeezed from your heart. Maybe there's a situation. Maybe there's sin in your life. Whatever it might be, bring it before the cross this morning and experience the love of God. Be freed from the bondage of sin. Be freed from the things that have happened and be free to love with God's love. Thus fulfilling the law of God, thus glorifying and honoring him, thus doing the thing that is our greatest good. Let's pray. Almighty God, we come before you in the name of Jesus. God, we are reminded that we are incapable of loving others. That in our sinful flesh, we have ulterior motives. We do things for our own purposes. But God, I pray that by your Spirit this morning, would you help us to genuinely love you and love others. Let your love saturate our hearts and our minds, drawing us closer to you. Let us throw down bitterness and unforgiveness. Place it before the cross. God, let us live lives that bring glory and honor to your name. Let us live lives that lift up Christ, that through the way that we love by the empowering of the Spirit, that others would see Christ. That the lost would see Jesus and see their great need for a Savior. So God, I pray, would we put the gospel on display by how we love others. In your name, Jesus, I pray and give thanks. Amen.
All right.
you stand with us again? Praise the Lord. Father's glory revealed in Jesus Christ, and the more that I behold him, the more he satisfies. When I gaze upon his beauty, when I see him as I should, then my eyes are lifted upward for his glory and my good. There is hope in every trial, for I can trust the Lord. He will turn my heart towards him and help me bear the thorn. So in faith I follow Jesus on the road not understood, for I know that he is working for his glory and my good. For my good, to our God, to our God, be the glory, to our God, be praise, he alone, the name above all names. I will boast ever only in the Lord, my God, for I know his glory. Jesus upon the cross that day, what they understood as weakness deserves my every praise. For the charge that was against me, it was nailed into the wood, yes, for I know that he has saved me for his glory and my good. To our God be would be made more, amen. Would I seek the only kingdom that far outweighs them all? I will stand before my Father where the faithful saints have stood, and with joy my heart shall praise him for his glory and my good. And with joy my heart shall praise him for his glory. To our God be the glory, to our God be praise, he alone, the name above all names. Sing it out. So I will boast ever only in the Lord, my God, for I am.
I don't want to pull an Arthur. This is what I call pulling an Arthur. But can we sing that chorus a cappella, please? Can we do that together? Church, is that okay? Can we do that together? Please.
To our God be the glory, to our God be praise, He alone, the name above all names. I will boast ever only in the Lord my God, for I know His glory is my good. For I know His glory is mine.
Amen. Praise the Lord. Praise God. Church, please, I encourage you, if you need to talk to one of the elders or one of the deacons here, or you need to talk to a brother and sister in Christ, I encourage you to do so, that you don't leave here by asking and praying with someone and saying, I need that to experience that love of God in my heart. I need help to be free to love God and love others. I would encourage you to do so. So we're going to read our benediction together. And when it's on the screen, please say amen.
Amen.
Amen. Let's read it together. May we grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. To Him be the glory both now and to the day of eternity. Amen. God bless you, church. You're dismissed.